Sword of Omens, give me sight beyond sight.
Yo, 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 what up?
Oh my god, he just ran in.
Yo, what's up, y'all? Mad Chiller here, bringing you guys another episode of Goon Squad Presents Two Props. Tonight we're discussing troubleshooting techniques and ways to get back in the air faster. Before we get started tonight, I want to plug the protest in D.C. on the 29th that the UFDA crew is sponsoring. Is that the right word? Chime in, Artie.
Sponsoring, hosting,
putting together, working their asses off on, man. Yeah. They've been busting their asses. So each and every week, we got to, until this shit happens and we meet up down there. You know, the link is in the description. Make sure you're aware of what's going on there. I also want to mention the flight test survey. Also, the link is in the description. Those guys are going to DC here really soon. Not sure the date, but really soon. And
it's asking, like a few days.
It's a few days away, yeah. And so we are making sure you guys are aware of that. Make sure you fill that out. I did it today. It took me like 3 minutes, maybe, if that. It's nothing major. You don't have to give them your name if you don't want. You have to give them permission to use your info or your testimony if you want to or you don't. It's up to you. But it just kind of lets them know what kind of pilot you are, the types of craft you're flying, where you fly, how far these proposed FRIAs could be from you, how it impacts you, things like that. Very important. So we're definitely all, you know, working on getting on that info. Before we start, a couple quick shout outs. We're going to start breaking these up so this isn't so long every night. So just to start off, we'd like to shout out BQE Multirotors, Fat Straps, Say Andrea, Team BQE, and the UFDA crew. And with that, I'm taking us over to the goons. Oh, or not. Oh, there he goes. What's up, fellas?
What's going on?
It's one of those nights.
What's going on? Yeah, man. Troubleshooting night.
We're already having trouble. Fuck.
How's everybody doing tonight? Thanks for coming out, man. We got the usual crew in here. We've got our man Vicious Vice in the house. How you doing, brother?
What up?
And of course, Red Five, the man, the myth. How you doing, dude?
Is he muted? He's muted. Okay, first troubleshooting.
Come on to bring that up.
Before you try to speak.
Unmute.
Unmute.
As I was saying, I'm standing by.
Oh, shit.
Right on.
And I failed to have it ready.
Red five, I'm going in.
That's what's up.
So, right.
Right on.
So what's going on, Artie?
Oh man, not too much. Been trying to troubleshoot a few things. I've got a buddy of mine's quads that I'm trying to fix. It's like about 8 or 10 of those things, and they're all
how big was this
stages.
How was this big was this box you received?
You know, it's 18 by 18.
What's that box?
A bunch of 5-inch quads and radio and a couple of batteries, man. It'll be fun, man. Something to do. So, but this whole kind of episode idea kind of got started because I believe you're having a bit of a rough week with some quids.
Yeah, which is ongoing. Yeah. Sorry, we checked audio. Anybody? Sorry, I'm still doing the technical hat. Vince, give me a thumbs up. God bless you, Vice.
Yeah, you're good.
Word. So anyways, yeah, man, last weekend I had two down, and I'm still very much scratching my head regarding both cases, to be honest. I mean, one of them I blew 4-in-1, so that's already have the replacement, and I'm switching that out, but I blew it for no good reason. So maybe I just got a dud? I don't know. It was brand new pretty much, so... and then the other one, I dropped the 10-inch about 20 feet out of a tree, upside down, face. Well, I think it hit the motors first, actually. But afterwards, every time I tried to arm it, it would reboot. And so in the process of troubleshooting, I thought I had it nailed. And when I plugged in a pack, it fucking melted down. and now I'm replacing a stack and probably a motor. So
that's always fun.
Yeah, it's not. It was. I don't know. It happens. You know. I mean, the reality is, I'm really blessed, bro. I have built two 10-inch quads, and I have another one that's in progress. That's a new build up. And so, you know, thank God for that. I have plenty of 5-inch quads and stuff, but you know how it is. You build a new rig. Unfortunately, one of my the rig that blew the 4-in-1 has been a problem for me since the day I built it. And it started with a bum motor bearing, and then it progressed, and I ended up blowing that stack up, and then replaced it, and had video problems after that. And it's just one. It was just literally one thing after another, and then. And then video problems got fixed, and I was good, and I thought I was good, and I literally just snagged up on a little ghost branch and blew the 4-in-1. So oh, shit. It was nothing. Like, it was...
Ouch.
Yeah, Vice was there. It was just one of those days. But then, thank God, I had the other 10, and I just sent it. Oh, wait, you weren't there, if that's right.
I was there the week before, where I think you just...
You weren't here this weekend, yeah. That's right.
Well... So we're talking about troubleshooting tonight. So tell us a bit about how you kind of go about figuring out what the problem is. Like, because you kind of go in, you know what happened as far as what's going on with it. How do you tackle trying to figure out what you look for first?
Well, I mean, the first thing is to eliminate every unnecessary variable you possibly can. All right. So if the quad isn't arming for whatever reason or something of that nature, I would literally start by disconnecting everything from the flight controller. I would disconnect my VTX. I would just get all that stuff out of the equation right out of the gate and see if there's any change. You know what I mean? Disconnect your camera. You can get a short in your camera. I've gotten a short in my camera. Get a short in your VTX. Some of these situations can backfeed voltage into your flight controller and cause all sorts of fucking havoc. So if you have any extra shit, pit switches, anything, get rid of it. Just get all that stuff down, nail it down to your fucking ESCs and your FC. And then, you know, at that point, you need to eliminate your FC. And so first thing I would do is just plug her into BL Hilly and see if I at least get communication through, you know, I get passed through, and I'll spin motors from the, you know, from the ESC. And see if there's any issues. You know what I mean? And so you're going to try to bypass as much as you possibly can. Plus, you're protecting your auxiliary components in that process. You know, you disconnect all that shit, plug it into BL Hilly, and just fire that up. And hopefully, if you have a bad motor, if you have a bad ESC, that's all you're going to fucking kill at the time. You know what I mean? But, I mean, that's, I think, the most paramount thing is just to strip it down to what you're absolutely trying to troubleshoot. And like, say in my case, a bad motor, you know, or a motor not spinning, or a motor behaving erratically, or whatever the case might be. And then if it spins up fine on BL Hilly, then I would look at
Hilly.
I would spin it up from whatever your config is. And then, I would attach an RX and spool it up from your radio. You know what I mean? And just you backtrack and take out everything you don't absolutely need to get that test done until you find whatever component is causing issue, ideally. In my situation yesterday, which we'll segue into a little bit about smoke. I want to talk about smoke stoppers, all right? But man, just, you know, elimination of anything that could be hindering success, right? Right off the top, and then work your way back.
Exactly. No, and that's how I like to go about things, is I just start trying to isolate where the problem is. If it's an obvious, like, okay, it's an ESC issue, or it's a motor, or, you know, something related to the motor or the ESC, you know, those become relatively easy to diagnose and figure out. If you can't get the ESC to do anything, then replace it.
Right.
Which is something that I don't like about 4-in-1 ESCs, which I've been reluctant to switch back to, because I'm so accustomed to having 4 individual ESCs that I can instantly diagnose which one's going wrong, try to flash it, try to do all the things that you can, make sure, you know, there's no shorts, check continuity,
right?
Make sure it's not making contact with the frame for whatever reason, and then move back from there and get to the FC or the PDB or whatever is the next step in the chain.
Yeah, totally.
Red Five, what are your typical, like, when you have something go wrong, what are the kind of tips and tricks you can give the guys about what you do to troubleshoot what's going on?
One thing that really helps with troubleshooting is buying quality parts, because when something does go wrong, I can usually narrow down what the problem is pretty quickly. I don't have to worry about, like, oh, is it my ESC? 9 times out of 10, when I do have issues, it's motor related. Probably the last time I actually had to troubleshoot, because I wasn't quite sure, was had a wreck, brought it back in from the Walk of Shame, replaced the props, went to take off, it would hover, and as soon as I'd give it some throttle, it just fall out of the sky. So the first thing I did was not unplug, looked at the OSD and saw that I had amp draw up to like 80. There's no way I drew 80 amps. You know, just on pure throttle alone. So it had to be something to do with the motor. It was probably bent, and it was probably bent really bad and caused a voltage spike, which KISS ESCs, they will just turn off. Identified pretty quickly that it was just a really, really, really bent motor.
Well, something that I kind of got into recently is I have a Eagle micro cam that when I would throttle hard would just gray out and brown out on me. And generally what I do is I check the connection first, check the cables, make sure there's not a break somewhere. Or maybe it's just barely hanging on somewhere. So I'll tug on those silicone wires. Because if you can, I mean, you should be able to pretty well yank on it without it breaking on you. So I usually start there. And it ended up being a pin on the camera that was just starting to break. And I dropped, floated a little solder in there. And now it's all honky-dory.
I had a camera yesterday, actually, when I was tearing down the bando. I was having intermittent issues with my camera control working. I always wear up camera control. It's weird. And so I fucking grabbed the camera and fucking wiggled the JST. Sure as shit, it was wiggly. So I was using the Caddx Rattel, and I popped it open, and which is a huge thing I do like about those cameras. You can still open them on the micros even. And so I pulled the phone back, and I looked at the pins wiggling it, and I wasn't getting the motion I expected, and so I kind of like looked on the other side a little bit, and I pulled on the connector a little bit, and I could tell that the actual pin itself had snapped flush with the PCB. So I got behind it, tapped it with my iron, yanked it off, and then got the other one hot, got a pair of really pointy, you know, tweezers in there, and pulled the leg out, and then I had a broken run cam I fucking, you know, scavenged off of, and had a donor. So I just used donor camera and grabbed it off, got that working. Ben, I think that some of the things you mentioned already, you know, checking for shorts, man, that's huge. And even though I did yesterday, I still got burned in the end, and I'm a little bummed about that one. Checking, you know, metering for continuity from your ESC motor wire, the pad connection to the fucking meter to the fucking motor bolts, shit like that. Check to make sure that motor isn't shorting out across any of those windings. None of the bolts are, you know, shorting out. Ground to the carbon, you know what I mean? Hot to the carbon. You want to check all that shit. You want to take your LiPo leads and check them for continuity. And a lot of times, if you're running caps and things, you'll get a short continuity burst, and then as all the caps charge up or whatever, that resistance goes down, and that goes away. So at that point, you know, check all of that. Check your LiPo leads. And again, I think you need, you know, if we get into specifics, like what are you troubleshooting, you know, that will kind of help define each thing. I'm trying to see whether I'm getting questions from the chat. But yesterday, man, I'm not going to lie. Generally speaking, I've never used any sort of popper stopper.
Yeah, me neither.
Have you ever used one?
I mean, I have never. Before. My first build, I made one. And I just got lazy after that. I've been soldering for a long time, man. So I'm very like particular about my solders. I like things to be clean. Once I solder, I scrub. Like, now this is only when I build it, right? Mm. Like, or if I have to pull something off, I generally do the same things. I'll clean it with some alcohol, and just double and triple check for little solder beads.
Right.
Because I've fried so many ESCs and FCs in the beginning, having those kind of issues.
Right.
And also quality iron, man. I can't stress that enough. It's get quality. And now we have some that are powered off LiPo that are as good as a $200 unit, as far as the tips are cheap.
Mm.
Like, they burn up pretty quick, but I run hot.
Right.
I like to go quickly, hot and quick with my solders. But just having quality equipment, period. So, and the other, to say one thing about what Red was talking about, Austin was talking about with getting quality parts, is also you get something behind that, some customer service. And like, you know, if you're shopping with TBS or Heli Nation, for instance, Mike Chin,
right?
Like, this dude is a
beast,
wizard,
right?
When it comes to everything, all those products,
right?
And always has an answer. So getting quality products usually comes with a little customer service that you can actually hit up and actually get some good answers from.
Yep.
So I wanted to touch on something that's non-quad related. So Artie, what your background is a luthier and in repair. Like, so Artie, if you guys don't know Artie or don't know any of his background, is Artie, you do a lot of repair and do some custom builds from the ground up?
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of where I started, was building guitars.
Right.
At a shop up in Michigan, and repairing too. I mean, it just kind of comes with the territory, but yeah, it's all problem solving, man. Just like electronics, it's all about process of elimination. And
I wanted to throw that out there just because, like, when Artie's discussing about tools and temperatures and things like that, he's got a wealth of knowledge in some of these areas that apply outside of drone electronics. And I also I've done a lot of instrument repairs throughout my life. And yeah, I am a big fan of soldering hot and using, I think that you were speaking of tips, I think changing tips, depending on what you're doing. You don't be lazy about it. Change your fucking tip. If you need a lot of heat, get a broader tip. If you're trying to do something fun, get a fine tip. Change your fucking tip. Use a little bit of flux. I prefer SMD flux because it's liquid. It burns fucking fast. But you, like, if you're like Artie and I that want to use, we use high heat and we hit it fast, make that connection. Like, you drop your wire on there, you hit it with heat, you pull it off, and it's fucking done. It's like,
yep.
Well, and the biggest tip for soldering I can give anybody is you got to heat the part.
Mm-hmm.
Like, whatever you're soldering to ideally needs to be hot enough to melt the solder to make that connection. So if you've tinned properly, it makes it easy to go really hot and fast.
Yes.
And occasionally I get a cold solder, but that's usually when I'm soldering on top of solder.
For me, I always get cold solders on my ground side, if anything, because the ground is there's a lot more copper in your grounding plane than anywhere else.
It's moving. It's all connected. So
and it fucking,
the trace is long as fuck.
It sucks up the heat. I have one gnarly, fatty, like 800 watt iron I used to do high voltage LiPo connections with, dude. And I just hit, bitch glows red hot. And I fucking just go, and I take it off and it's fucking done, man. But,
just go get you that Hacko, what is it, 6828 something, I don't know, or the Weller, what's it, M50. That's what I've had, and I've had it for 12 years, and it's
still, I mean, it's fine up to a certain gauge, but once I get into, like, once I start getting into doing, like, 10 gauge and shit like that.
10 gauge wire, I mean, it's just all, for me, it's all about the tip. If you're wanting to heat a 10 gauge wire up, you need a flat, broad tip.
Yeah.
So your surface, it's all about
surface area, right? Absolutely.
And also when you solder at lower temperatures, there's more potential for those little beads that just fucking ruin your day, period.
Yeah, Oates and chat nailed it. Get in, get out.
Get in, get out.
Real quick.
Yeah, I think that's clutch. And I think that's, you know, I'm actually here to say that I'm going to build a 6S popper stopper, and I'm probably going to build a couple variations because you can build the fucking things so goddamn cheap. And there's really no reason not. If you have a suspect quad, especially if you have a ESC or motor-related suspect quad, yeah, a fucking popper stopper can save you a lot of grief. And so back to what I was saying earlier, like with this particular situation, I have done my diligence. My build is, all my soldering joints were really good. I found what may have been a cold solder joint on my cap negative in the build. But otherwise, everything else fucking checked out from all my normal checks. I mean, I checked ground for shorts. I checked everything. And with a battery at storage voltage, I could spin up my motors and I could pump my throttle and it was fine. But my LEDs were dimming. And my LEDs are coming off the LiPo connection. So they were dimming, right? And so I'm like, okay, well, maybe, you know, LEDs have a cutoff voltage and they, you know, when they get low, they're going to go out. So I'm like, well, maybe it's just that, you know. So I fucking charge up the pack. Fucking get on the bench, plug it in, fucking fire it up, and I'm boom, a spark shoots off my fucking flight controller. And then I get smoke out of one, a little bit of smoke out of one of my motors. And as soon as I got the fucking spark, I was reaching for it. And as I'm unplugging it, one of my motors starts smoking. And I'm just like, motherfucker, you know? And it's just like, I blew two things in the matter of fucking like 3 seconds. And I'm talking, you know, $50 FC and a $40 motor. And definitely there's an ESC problem. You know what I mean? So like, and quite honestly, dude, a $5 smoke stopper would have fucking solved that. Now, I don't know which one you're showing, Vince, but
looks like the RDQ.
This is from the RDQ, I believe.
And what pack, RDQ. What is that rated for? What's the voltage rating?
I do believe it does 6S.
Yeah, I think it's a 6S.
I'll actually check the website. Yeah, I'll check the website.
You know, it's funny. I had something kind of funny happen on my, like, this was my gold standard quad. I literally had the same FC and ESCs for almost a year and a half. Kiss, by the way, if you didn't, or if you didn't know, that shit's quality. It's expensive as fuck, but I've been rocking it for a year and a half. Same flight controller, but I rock it with a Wolf PDB, and I had the Wolf E1. And it was in my reverb, which sits up on some standoffs.
What up, yo? PDB Jones is, FPB in the chat. Sorry.
This PDB sticks to your frame. Like, that's generally how it was designed to mount with some double stick. But when I transferred it to my Aliens, I was just using some double-sided tape, VHB. I wanted to say GHB. VHB to kind of pad between the nuts and the PDB, and it's worked for a year and a half. So the other day I got my kids a trampoline for Christmas, so I went to do a bounce on it, and it's like, as soon as I hit that, it just stopped. It just sparked, smoked, and flipped over. I ran, got it, went and unplugged it. And couldn't really tell what was going on. Like, I could tell, you know, there was smoke, but there was nothing burned on the PDB. There was no signs of something burning.
Mm-hmm.
And the smell was everywhere. So I couldn't like pinpoint it by smell or anything like that. So I just went and tapped a battery on it just to see if it would still fire right back up. And then of course it sparked. And what had happened was the PDB had worn through the, over time, worn through the VHB, finally made it to the nut, scraped off that coating, and it was copper. And then bluey, my cap blew up. There's a hole in the corner of this PDB. It was fantastic. But the funny thing was when I did that, I was holding the frame.
Right.
Right. And immediately, like, burnt the fuck out of my hand.
Right.
So I plugged in a fully charged 6S pack, and the frame instantly got just blazing hot.
24 volts is no joke. And as you build into 8 and 12S, it even becomes crazy, even scarier. I'm like, as I'm building my first 8S, I'm like, okay, like, I've seen some shit catch fire already. What's gonna, you know, like, what the fuck? it's a journey. It's exciting. But yes, extra diligence as you increase voltage. So as Vince was just putting up there, that particular smoke stopper he has is only rated to 5S. So it's just 224 volts. So they give it a 5S rating. And what it's a point I wanted to make, because so if you're not aware, a lot of the tutorials online tell you to use a fucking 12 volt, effectively a car tail light as the fuse. And the advantages of any sort of filament based system is when it's ready to blow, it's going to blow fast, right? It's going to be faster than a fuse. First of all, I wanted to mention that you need to build these things accordingly or buy them accordingly, whichever the case may be, because if you plug in one that's the wrong voltage and you got somebody, you're still going to have fucking problems, because the reality is, even though a lot of those have diodes and they have various types of fusing or something in them.
Or filament,
right? It all depends on how you build them. You still can have problems. So first and foremost, fucking make sure you're set for your rated for your voltage when you are going to use them. Now, you can get some 24 volt lamps on Amazon and shit, but there's a pretty good prop wash. Oh, it's an older prop wash video from like two years ago, and it's actually linked in the description. And So aside from using a light bulb, which is fine, a light bulb's great, the next move is to get yourself a fuse holder and get yourself a fast acting fuse rated at your voltage. And I would say around 2 amps, between 2 and 2.5 amps is probably good. The light bulbs run about 2.5 amps if you wire both filaments in parallel. So looking into that, you can get a fuse holder and a fucking fuse for a couple bucks, right? I mean, and then you're using two XT60s to get your pack through it, and everything still applies as like in the prop washed. I have it, Vince. I'm gonna bring it up actually. I have advice. It's in the link, and I'm actually gonna take it full screen. So, very simple. They talk about bulbs. They talk about fuses a bit. All right, fuse is probably a really easy way to go as well, because you can definitely get a rating for what you need. Less delicate situations, you can absolutely use a circuit breaker, and they do have circuit breakers that are fast acting, and those are resettable. Now, obviously, when you blow a fuse or a light bulb, you've got to replace the fuse or light bulb. So in the case of these miniature circuit breakers, you just reset it, right? And you don't have to replace anything. So it's should work pretty much indefinitely. And you can get one for $5 in the link here for a 3 amp one. Now the downside to any sort of a switch mechanism, they tend to react a little bit slower because they're based on heat. All right. And so what happens is it heats up, it ultimately trips the switch inside and it releases the circuit. So they're not quite as fast, but this will absolutely fucking save your motor when your ESC's fucked up. All right. This will most likely save your FC and things of that nature. It might not save everything. It may not save your VTX if you have it connected. That's why I say I tend to disconnect everything I am not concerned about at the moment and try to get those out of the equation when I have a major problem, right, that I know something could burn up. Right, so we're kind of getting down to how to not blow your shit up at all, guaranteed. If you have a big motor problem, this might be something you want to build. Now, one other thing that I was going to bring up, because I've done some research into, is where are they? Okay, you can actually buy these, and you can buy these rated for 24, 30 volt, 36. Etc. And these are literally what's called a poly switch resettable device. And what basically happens is, as you overdraw current, there's crystals inside, and as you overdraw the current, those crystals get warm and they basically shrink and you lose conductivity. They're super fast
and you heal your soul.
And what happens is once it actually trips, you just unplug it and let it cool off, and it works again. And you can buy them for 50 cents.
That's cool.
From like Mauser, DigiKey, whatever. So this is just another option that I'm checking out. And you could definitely build these, because nobody wants to replace light bulbs or necessarily carry a light bulb around, maybe, so there's a couple different ways you could approach a smoke stopper. And for me, yesterday, I should have been, honestly, I've never actually gotten a situation quite like this before, because like I said, the quad was acting mostly normal at this point, and I'd toned out fucking every connector on it. It just, I don't know, maybe I had a bad FET. I'm coming down to, I have a bad FET that flipped out and shorted out. You know what I mean? But I don't know yet. I don't know. And so I have to go through the actual LED circuits and make sure there was nothing shorting out there. I haven't found anything yet. I'm checking every fucking motor, and I had my VTX and everything else disconnected at the time, so I know they're not a factor. You know what I mean? So.
Yep. Yep, yep. Well, and then also there's always the, if you can't figure out what it is, start replacing some stuff.
Oh, shit.
Brute force it.
unfortunately, sometimes that's the only way.
Well, also, unfortunately, though, sometimes you end up blowing shit up again, too. So you have to be, it's a double-edged sword.
Well, but that's why it's key to work from motor in.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or from power source out.
Like, for my bando, I'm technically not even sure if what I'm replacing was the problem, because my FC would just reboot midair. So I got a new FC, which also blew out my VTX, so I got a new VTX.
See, that could be your ESC, but depending on where you're getting. So that could be your ESC. You know, that could be the beck in your ESC. And that's a major problem, because if you're powering your flight controller off your beck, off your ESC, and then you're flying your RX, or sorry, you're also powering your RX off your FC, and you're powering a GPS off your FC, and maybe you're powering your camera off your FC, and that beck fries and shorts, especially if it sends VBAT down that shit, you're fucked.
And that's also a good tip, man. Yeah. Always check those kinds of things. You can get your multimeter out and see if those are going bad pretty simply.
Yeah.
And unplug FC and all the peripherals to check. And again, it's that process of elimination. And unfortunately, for most things, at least I've found, I've been repairing guitars for almost 12 years now.
Those were problems I was running into before I switched to KISS, because I was running Bardwell boards. And the 5-volt regulator kept frying on them fucking things.
Mm-hmm.
So I would fall out of the sky, camera would go.
Yep. But it's not something you really even think of until it happens. And you like, oh shit, don't do that again.
Mm-hmm.
Check this first before I fucking do this. And honestly, that's how I figured out guitar repair. It was, you got to run into the situation to be able to try to sit down and figure out how to approach it. Or see it from the aftermath. And which is, again, why we're trying to have this show tonight, is just to share our experiences and our little faux pas that we've run into and figured out good ways to get around. So back to advice. Have you run into anything and kind of got any tips and tricks on how you go about?
I mean, when I have the source of a wealth of information with this guy down here, you know, I just kind of like, hey, Chad, I have this problem, and you know, he'll walk me through a lot of the elimination. So I've, you know, for me, like, you know, I'm probably the least experienced here. So this is probably my first time having to do, you know, trial and error to figure out what's wrong. Because previously it's, oh, I broke a motor, or I broke an antenna, or the camera's dead.
You know, it's like super easy,
no problem. You know, I plug in a different camera, it works. All right, camera's dead. Or VTX, like, I had to figure out why my VTX wasn't turning on. So I plugged in a brand new VTX, same one, wouldn't turn on. All right. Changed to a different pad, started working. All right. Flew it, still turned off in the midair. So I actually got a chance to talk with Mike Chin, because we were just in a random chat, and I just randomly asked him. And he said probably what happened is, since I crashed real hard into something, the prop got stopped. And all that amperage and stuff went back into the board.
Backfed.
Back into the VTX.
Yep.
Fried the VTX, fried the board, and that. And so, and I've been kind of working on with that information in mind. So I got a new FC, I got a new VTX, and now I just got to put it all together, because last week I got real busy, so I'm at work.
I mean, that's
Let's be real, man. Building quads, it's same as guitars. building quads new is so much more fun than repairing quads that are already put together. Like, I put my shit together so that I can, but ultimately,
by nature, yes. But I mean, if you build a certain way, though, I've found I build with repair in mind. You know what I mean? And I think that's important, because that again, will let you disconnect things quickly, and not have a mess, and just things of that nature.
Well, it's also why I like you know, the bus frames, like the Alien. You got a lot of space. Most things I can usually get to without taking the quad apart. At least most of the minor things, like, and of course ESCs, because they're on my arms. Having that space and being able to place things in places that you can easily get to, so that pulling a plug isn't a pain in the dick, or getting to your receiver doesn't require you taking your entire build apart.
It sucks, it's
clutch, the bando. If you're not familiar with the bando is like super, super, super slammed, super tight.
Yeah, it is.
There's like no room for extraneous material. Like that frame is a work of art.
I'm lucky. I can stuff a fucking Unify Pro 32 in the trunk of mine. So I mean,
yeah, because you're just a 10-inch.
Stuck the I have 18 millimeters of fucking bottom plates.
This thing is,
Actually, no, it's more than a. No, it is 18 mil. I'm sorry. It is 18. I think, honestly, that's what happened to my quad, honestly, Artie, is I think I backfed. One of my motors stopped up and backfed into the ESC and blew something. It blew one of the FETs or something. Something was shorting the fucking ground, because it ultimately blew the fucking negative pin. It charred the negative pin on my LiPo connector in the process. So, I mean, something fucking shorted. And but it was crazy because, like I said, I did all the diligence I could possibly do to make sure there's,
and again, sometimes it's just fucked. You know what I mean?
I honestly think that's probably one of the top three issues that kills things is over, voltage spikes. Because you'll hear about people
with turtle mode. Turtle mode out of trees. Like a lot of people. Luckily now, at least with KISS, I have a lot less of that happening because the ESCs are so good, because Felix is such an animal about his design.
Yeah, they have aggressive voltage protection.
Yeah, they really do. So I burn a motor before I burn ESCs, usually. Every once in a while that's happened. And the couple of ESCs that I have burned have been in situations like that, where I was caught on a branch and I was trying to turtle or throttle out of it and just get it to move.
Yep. Yeah, because you'll hear people like, I just had this light crash and I smoked this or that, and it must be garbage because it was just such a light crash. What they're not telling you is, I was full throttle when I did the light crash, and it took too long to kill it.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't disarm it immediately.
Or if
I've run into that a couple times.
What no one really talks about is static electricity. So look. Fresh brand new part, they'll build, they'll plug in, and it's just dead, and they attribute it to manufacturer error or just poor quality. And static electricity doesn't have to be the painful kind where you can see and hear a jump or feel it. It can be silent, where you don't even know you had a static discharge because you mishandled it. And the whole thing's fried.
Well, that brings up a good point, man. Arcing of any nature is bad. Period. Touching back on what myself and what my friend Travis has found a couple of times, on some of these bigger rigs, if your cap comes loose for whatever reason.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It will fucking wreak havoc. It will wreak fucking havoc on your system. And that's actually what I thought was my case in this situation. But they will. And the other thing I wanted to mention in that, though, you guys also brought up talking about, the motor backfeeding and things of that nature and creating spikes. I do not use a ground strap, actually. But I started using the TVS diodes, which seem to have been pretty helpful in in helping to regulate spikes. Transient voltage suppression diode is what it's called. And it's something else that people should look at to help with some of this. And even though, I mean, even with all these things, with good caps and all this this protection, you know, power protection in your ESCs and your KISS ESCs, whatever, you're going to burn something up somewhere. If something gets, you know.
And I think a good side note and pro tip is just, if you're going out to, like, especially somewhere like Epic, like you're going to a sick location that you're not going to get to go back to, or it's somewhere that, it's Christmas Day and you're not going to get to hit it for another 6-8 months, make sure, go over your shit, man. Just take a look at everything, especially things that are hanging loose, like caps, and make sure that you've got, you know, some kind of strain relief on your power leads. I can tell you that was one of the most significant changes to builds that I did, you know, a couple of years ago. It was like, oh man, I should put some strain relief on this, so when the LiPo gets yanked off, it doesn't yank it off the PDB.
Yeah, nothing like pulling a LiPo pad off the four in one or the PDB. It's fucking, that sucks.
Especially if there's the bottom.
Yeah, it just ends the session for you.
I mean, I've cracked the actual 4-in-1 or PDB at the pad right there. I've cracked the pad, and that fucks things up, because that's not as easy to catch all the time. You know what I mean? You may not notice it right away, but if you fucking torque it hard enough one way or the other, you can create a hairline crack across a trace that will make contact when it wants, and then when it isn't, it will start arcing. You know,
and that's another thing about checking, like, for whatever reason with run cam cams, I've had this happen several times with that. And it could be the way that I'm running the wire, cause I do twist it, and I usually give myself a little slack, but anyway,
I started twisting now.
I have, where you have strands that slowly break internally. And gotten brownouts because it's just not able to carry it when you're at full throttle. You'll still see the OSD, so you know it's not your OSD chip or your VTX, but it's your camera. And just double checking those. This also happened on VTXs too. Sometimes it's just a break in the wire internally that you can't really see. But again, give it a little yank it on your cables a little bit. Because if anything just pulls off with, you know, just not really forcing it, but giving it a little pressure. If anything pops, then something's wrong. The solder's bad. It's a broken wire. And things that don't have all the strands connected can cause some havoc as well.
Bone FPV in the chat. What's up, Bone? Mike's Camping was discussing ground straps, and I use them on computers quite often, but not so much on quad builds.
So explain the ground strap to me.
It's basically like a wrist strap, and they usually have a breakaway connector on it, and it has a lead that comes down like an alligator clip, and you can actually, you usually want to ground yourself to the item that you're working.
Okay.
And then so like as Red Five was saying, you know, you in cases of static is real. I mean, you know, everybody's environment obviously differs, but it, you know, it's in the winter.
You don't have that problem
in the winter time, you know, in the north when it gets cold and you have snow and all that, and all the humidity gets pulled out of the air, and you run your feet across the carpet with fucking socks on, you are charged, you know. And so, like, that's, you know, environment. I think it does differ. I'm on hardwood here. I don't have any carpet, and I'm on hardwood and tile, so I don't really seem to suffer from too many static issues here. We do have boiler heat, so it does get a little bit on the dry side, but I try to use a humidifier a little bit when I need to. You know what I mean? So I think that you have to be aware of static, though, as an environmental factor. If you
anything under 45% humidity, static starts becoming a problem.
And like I said, it doesn't have to be the kind that jumps. Like, you can have static that you will never even know was actually,
you're just discharging it. Yeah,
arcing.
Yeah.
And that could be enough to kill components. Like, I guarantee you, if people wore the static straps during builds, you'd hear less about failing components.
Dead on arrival.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure, because there's going to be some of that. But at the same time, like, when you open a package, you plug up the thing for the first time and it doesn't fire up. I'm sorry. It's still
manufacturer.
Well, then, I mean, yes. Dude, it's got to happen. You know, shit is going to come DOA. I don't care. Like, anybody who's making thousands of anything, they're going to have fails. And the reality is there's not, you know, these things, especially off-season stuff, they're getting put together. They're obviously not tinned. They haven't been soldered. They're not being, you know, I'm sure they run certain tests on them. But the reality is they're not running a full-blown flight test on this shit before they put it in the package and send it to you. So, I mean, it's going to – the fucking fails are going to come through. It sucks. It's part of it. It's part of any component game.
I guarantee you, especially this hobby, the way new stuff comes – it just gets pumped out. I guarantee you, like, the failure rates for things are probably above 15%.
Well, I think I was watching a kebab video – not too long ago, happy and model. Happy model, 60% fail rate.
Ooh,
not this is what they shoot for. They shoot for, like, that's their standard, is 60%. Like, it's they're doing having
it's
a
like
good
playing
day.
The lotto.
They don't give a fuck. If no fucks given a happy model
work.
I don't know. I don't want to jinx myself, but my happy my mob six is okay right now. That's all I'm gonna
I've
say.
I've actually heard nothing but
by
great
the way,
things
I fixed
about
my
the
mob shit.
Six.
Oh, what did you do? So what did you do? So Vince's mob six was falling out of the sky.
I just like the battery leads were just not properly soldered on. Like, I pulled it off. I was like, is it like what is wrong? I'm like, oh, the fucking leads are like barely
cold
soldered
solder.
On. Yeah. Yeah, and the camera is like sitting on top of this copper wire, and the copper wire is the VTX, like,
so
it's just
so
an unshielded
weird.
Copper wire.
Why is yours like?
Yeah, because you have an awesome version.
Yes, I have a fucking. So whatever I can say. So I guess that's, you know, happenstance because I fly a Nirvana radio, and so I decided to buy the fucking FlySky version of the Mob 6. And apparently the dudes and dudettes in the FlySky part of the factory are doing a good job because my shit seems to be working. And I got a proper VTX antenna and a proper RX antenna on mine that's like long and stuff. And yeah, it's really interesting.
Yeah, you actually have an antenna.
I was talking to Patrick about
you have
that.
Actually real antennas.
I was talking.
So what's the difference? Where did yours come from and where did yours come from?
Mine's probably an old batch is what it is. And his is probably a newer batch. I got mine from Pyro, but like when he mentioned them, like, oh, we only have a few left. This is like an old batch, get a new batch, you know, in like 2 weeks or something. But like, I wanted to get it because I was going to go to this thing. Yeah, I mean, it works in the house sometimes. Now. I mean, it's just really bad reception.
I have a
the good news is you build quads, so you know how to fix it.
I have a theory. So, a theory about this Mob 6 situation, by the way. So RDQ got the first period shipment, right? I don't know what they did, but somehow RDQ got the first.
Probably sold out.
They had them like almost they had the almost a month before everyone else, right? So RDQ sold out, and then whatever a while goes by, and then the resupply comes in or whatever, right? So Pyro got them, I noticed, and I'm not sure where else, but then Pyro got them. And they had them for like a week. And then it seemed like everybody else got them and RDQ got them again. And my theory is that RDQ got the second version. You know what I mean? But I haven't confirmed on the FR Sky side of things because everybody I know that's into these has already gotten one. You know what I mean? But I have spoken with Patrick from Project Mockingbird about his, and we were just talking about the differences in the build. So I'm actually about to pop the top off this and take some pictures and change. I'm gonna change the canopy out.
Right on.
But
how's the frame holding up?
Fine so far. I did buy some Beta FPV Meteor frames, but they're a little heavier and a little, but they're a little more durable. Yeah. So I got that, and I got a newbie drone dad hat. So it's going to be like half a fucking Mob 6 when I'm done with it. It'll be like electronics, basically.
Well,
but
just know you got that 40%. You were in that 40%.
So. Yeah, right? Like, maybe it's the FlySky division that cares enough to make sure they don't fail. And that's FRSky guys are like, don't give a fuck. I don't know.
I'll be right back.
It's the FRSky line, bro.
But that's funny. So we're off topic about troubleshooting to some degree. But so did you have any tactic of troubleshooting, Vince, when you got it, or you just inspection?
I just looked at it. I'm like, wow, this looks like crap. And then I just made the changes and then plugged in a fresh battery. worked fine. Flew it around the house for a little bit. I haven't flown since I got it working just because of work stuff. But I'm probably this Friday after work, I'll probably just charge a bunch of packs and fly around the office I work at.
Oh, hell yeah. Wish I could fly around the office.
But yeah, I think I just got lucky that it worked. Like, I don't know why it didn't work, but I know I got it to work eventually.
So, well, if it didn't have a solid power connection, you were just browning out.
Well, these connectors, the PH 2.0 or whatever, these connectors are notoriously dodgy in themselves.
I thought they were.
Well, they got the new one, the 2.0, what the hell is it called? It's the one that Beta FPV uses. It's the BH or something. It's like a
BH2.
It's the new one, and that supposedly BH2, gives you more amperage throughput. Actually, I don't know.
Yeah, a little bit.
But the
especially for me, it wasn't worth it getting all new batteries.
The one before this one was even worse.
For sure.
Whoop power connectors are always dodgy, and they've always recommended you change them out.
Well, that's why I've been waiting for the brushless for a while, just so I can get one with an XT30. Because
I wouldn't put an XT30 on this thing. It would make it too fucking heavy. I would get that new BH or whatever the hell, the new 2.0 connector.
Well, I mean, but that's a 1S kind of quad, really.
Well, right? Yeah, it's a 1S. Yeah, I mean, I use an XT30 on my 3S, my pickpocket whoop. Of course, but Right, so what other crazy shit has happened to your quads that it took you a second to figure out? Or
to be honest with you, I've kind of covered most of this stuff with mine. I mean, the biggest things I found is, like I said, working from the motors in or the power out,
mm-hmm.
Depending on, you know, what's going on.
Yeah,
what happened.
I think it's...
You know, the good thing about products today that when I started didn't necessarily happen is you've got a lot of indicator lights to let you know in a lot of cases whether something's turning on or not, right? And that can, like, for ESCs, having a little LED on it, or at FC, having those things fire up and have tones, like the ESCs having a startup tone, you know, those can be show you kind of where things are starting to go wrong.
Sure.
When you don't see or don't have that, but just being diligent and going one step at a time and eliminating something and moving in and eliminating the ESC and moving in.
Yeah, I mean, I think you start at one end. It's a point A to Z, like, you know, it just like, or even yeah, just
if you're ADHD
A-B.
Like me, man, it's a. You can get distracted and start fucking with other shit, but it's just be diligent, move in one direction at a time. And if you can do that, you'll figure it out. Unfortunately, sometimes it's just a matter of, oh shit, we got to replace it.
I mean, again, though, like you said, start either in the motor side or the fucking LiPo side, but in the, you know, but you're taking a straight line to your destination. And I've kind of talked about the straight line in my powering schemes before. Straight line. It, you know, and eliminating anything else that would sidetrack you. You know what I mean? Like, what is your problem? My VTX doesn't work. How is it powered? You know, is it powered directly from your LiPo? Is it directed to your flight controller? Okay, so, you know, I've seen people that have gotten small breaks or somehow gotten cut somewhere along the way, but it wasn't really obvious. Like, meter the fucking pins on the fucking JST going into your VTX. Meter. Yeah,
the multimeter is your friend. Like,
absolutely. You know, meter the pins on the connector. Bags. Meter the solder joints going into it. Meter the output. Like, are you powering your camera from the VTX? Meter that power. Starting from the top, you know, from your battery to the end of your video chain, and just work your way through it one step at a time in one direction from point, you know, like I said, point A to Z or whatever. You know, everything starts at power and ends either in your battery or ends with your camera or starts your camera. And, you know, but the power wise, it all starts from your battery, goes to your camera. You know, power wise, starts with your battery and goes to your motor. You know, there's ESCs in the way. Absolutely. You know, what is in the way? Okay, and that line is your PDB and your ESC or your 4-in-1 or whatever the case may be. Yeah. You're going in a line. and then going up from there in your stack, you're going to your flight controller. You know, how's your flight controller powered? If you're powering your VTX on the 5-volt rail, how is that flight controller getting this 5-volt? Is it generating it? Is it taking it from the ESC? Because the 5-volt back on your ESC could go out. Maybe your flight controller is getting power another way. I don't know. You know, there's various different, there's different things that could be going on there, you know.
Exactly.
Metering.
And,
well,
and how about video issues? Like, what are some tips and things that you think of? Let's say your camera blows out, you get a gray screen.
I mean, you know, I think logically speaking, it's really important to have some sort of plastic utensil. Plastic
chopsticks, buddy.
Tweezers. Or chopsticks. Yeah, yeah, chops, you know, but I mean, I like plastic tweezers or something, or because I like them. Chopsticks are a little too blunt and too round for me, but I like to have
some sharp chisels around, bro. Everything gets pointy.
Yeah, yeah, true. I mean, but I like to kind of be able to grasp something and wiggle it, which obviously you can do with chopsticks, but not every fucking buddy can use chopsticks properly. So that's a whole other story. Anybody can use a tweezer. Yeah. All right. So, like, fucking, you know, probing your board actually is, you know, from point A to B, you know, was it a video signal issue or is it a power issue? You know, number one, if you know you have a video issue, try to get some DVR because DVR can tell you a lot. You know, do you still see your OSD? Is it a complete rollout? You know, are you dropping signal and having some other weird shit go on? I mean, if you've got a steady, solid frame, but and your OSD is staying locked, then you know it's your video coming from the camera somehow through the flight controller to get to the VTX. Again, straight line, right? And what are we talking about? Are we talking power? Are we talking signal? You know, you need to follow those lines and think as like pipes. Everything's like water going through pipes, and they might stop off somewhere for a while, but then they keep going, right? And so, like, try to imagine those lines, right?
Another solid thing is check those couplings, man. Check your solders, poke on them, pull on them. Again, if anything just pulls off 9 times out of 10, that may be a start of your problem.
You know, make sure that when you're building, make sure you're tinning well. You're tinning well, you know, get some solder in that wire, inside the wire.
Into the wire,
And I mean, if some people,
not just on the outside,
something that some people may not even necessarily know, but solder always travels towards the heat. It flows towards the heat. It's attracted by heat. So if you put your soldering iron on one side of the wire, you know, soldering iron and then wire and then solder from the other side, you're going to pull solder through the wire as it heats up and melts in.
Yeah.
And so you can actually direct the flow of the solder based on the heat and how you're positioning it. But tinning is making sure you're tinning appropriately when you build is clutch to start with. But then past that, like, you know, being able to probe, if you have an intermittency, especially, that's what drives me crazy. And that's what I had yesterday. I had intermittency. I had a problem that it wasn't constant, it wasn't consistent, it just happened every so, you know what I mean, it was working but not quite working, you know what I mean? And those are the situations that really, like, where now you have to start getting a little deeper. Again, you have to try to eliminate things, and in many cases sometimes you're not going to find it. Like, it may just be your ESC or whatever. Ultimately, you're going to bring the problem out, which is what happened with me. But
exactly,
but
it just depends on what kind of bull you are.
But I've had an ESC, for example, that, dude, I soldered it up, I'd fucking, half the time I'd arm the quad and all my fucking, you know, motors took off and I could fly around for a whole pack more, a couple packs.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden my motor wouldn't arm, my ESC wouldn't arm. And then I would take it apart and I'd fuck with it and check all my solders and I'd put it back together and it would work on the bench. And as soon as I went to the flight line, it was a race quad, fucking ESC would stop working again. And then, so I got it and I literally took a pen cap and I started just prodding the ESC, right? And I had the props off and everything, and I just spun it up on idle, and I just started prodding the ESC, and when it wouldn't start. So I would start it, I'd stop it, I'd start it, and it wouldn't start. And then I would fucking touch around, or if it would start, I would touch around, and I would wait to see if I could make it fail, right? And I sure as shit, I just found there was a fucking cap that one side must have had a cold solder joint, and so depending on how tight the shrink wrap was that day, it would make the connection or let the connection fucking become intermittent. And so literally just tapped it with an iron and fucking fixed it straight up.
One thing we haven't really touched on is software troubleshooting. And this kind of goes back to what Artie was saying earlier about checking your stuff before you fly. An issue I recently had, like Sunday, went out to the field, didn't check my stuff, went out to the field. It's like an hour, like a half hour drive. Got to the location and my quad just started, like it would arm, prop spin, right direction. I'd give it a little bit of throttle and it would just shoot straight up, spinning. Oh, and shit.
What was going on?
I immediately knew what the problem was because it couldn't have been anything else. So the day prior, or no, actually the week prior, I hadn't flown in a week. I'd plugged in my quad and I wanted to know what the motor order was for a hex. So I flipped through the option, brought up hex, and I left my quad there, came back and was like, oh, let me change my tune a tiny bit. So I altered some numbers and hit save. And totally forgot about the pod being in a hex.
That's brutal, man. Yeah, I always hate that. I've done that several times where I'm setting up, especially new quads or something I'm repairing, and I put new firmware or something on, and then just forget to set idle up properly.
I mean, that's...
Because that's what I use. I use idle up, so...
Yep.
not setting that min at 1060 and whatever, the min command or whatever. So getting all the way to the field, go to fire up and just no yaw authority, like no yaw, no roll, just up and down.
Yeah. And had I actually just, you know, plugged in, you know, at the driveway, tried just to make sure, cause I thought I was sure it was good. I would have caught the error, solved it. And then would have went out and had a good time flying. Instead, I had to go all the way back home. By the time I got home, it started raining, so I didn't get to fly Sunday. And then I spent probably a good 2 hours driving on President's Day trying to find somewhere to fly.
Yeah, because there was everybody was out in Memphis.
Fucking, so you don't have a tablet? You don't take a tablet to the field?
I don't have a tablet, and I didn't have keychain configurator. So I
was
going
to say that here's a good spot to plug that thing. That KISS keychain configurator is a baller for those reasons.
Alex says that Pyrodrone will probably have it in stock on Friday.
Can you program your ESCs with that keychain? You know?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's cool. You
can literally do everything you can do in the configurator.
So for everyone else who's not on KISS, I mean, fucking having a goddamn tablet is clutch.
I will say something about software is if for whatever reason you get in a situation, and this happened to me a lot with Betaflight, but this was of course 2 years ago when I was flying it regularly. You just get some weird oscillation that you just could not get rid of, or some kind of funky yaw twitch or something like that. It used to help me more times than I'd like to admit, just reflashing firmware. You just got some lost packet somewhere in the download or in the upload. It just seemed like sometimes that would be the fix for something stupid.
Reflashing, yep. And full chip erase is the number two.
Full chip erase is key.
But I mean, but in terms of troubleshooting a rig that's already up and running, like you know, more or less, like in Austin's case, I mean, you know, having a tool in the field with you is very clutch. I mean, you know, it's great that you have some of the, you know, the iPhone and Android apps allow you to adjust your, you know, like your FC settings and things of that nature. But at the end of the day, if you need to get deep into BL Heli or fucking, you know, something of that nature, you don't have a tablet. You're Austin driving home. So, you know what I mean? And so at the end of the day, you can run most of this shit on a pretty modest, cheap ass sub $200, and I was running on an $80 tablet at one point. Didn't run real well, but it ran, you know. But I mean, you know, I got an
I got myself a little laptop.
ASUS Transformer, man. I got one for like 200 and some change, you know, like that was clutch. But you know, to really get down to it, you know, coming back to it, it's like you're troubleshooting a software issue potentially. First things first, plug into BLHeli or whatever your ESC configurator is and check your motor numbering. Then check your direction. And then you need to look carefully about things. There was a period of time within, I don't know, probably about a year and a half, 2 years ago, where, you know, people wouldn't know that they needed to set their yaw mixing when they wanted to run props out. And there was a period of time where it wasn't just a switch in Betaflight. So people would run props out and they would spin their motors around in BLHeli or whatever. And so their motors are going the right direction. Their props are on the right way, but their quad's flipping the fuck out. Well, in that case, you know, that's a, there's a mix setting that you need to look at right there. And in that case, it was the yaw mixer for mixing reverse props. But you know, again, starting from the beginning, start with your ESC, start with your motors, start with the direction, start with the numbering, and then move back into the flight controller. And most softwares, EMU Flight, Betaflight, KISS, you know, you can turn the PID controller off while you're on the table. You know what I mean? And you can give it, you can even give it throttle and stuff, and you can get response, but you won't get the PID controller trying to counteract the lack of motion at that point, right? So you can do some things, right, to play around with your quad and see what's going on. And so at that point, you can eliminate the PID controller. If you arm the quad and don't give it any throttle, you can pick it up and you can play around with it and make sure that nothing is acting weird without the PID controller active. Then you could turn on the PID controller, you know, and see if you have the problem now. And then you know it's in, like, that's in your PID, part of your PID controller.
That's another reason that I do use Idle Up, is because I can spin the motors up. It's a great way to check and balance bent props, get them in line as perfectly as you can. And you just troubleshoot some little things where you're not worried about you're canceling out that PID controller and can see what's going on. Cause that, I tell you what, man, that's been one of the most beneficial things as far as figuring out a motor or an ESC is going bad before something major happens to it.
That or just having a gnarly wreck and going, is everything okay?
Yeah,
flip. Yeah, we're good.
Right.
I will say Flight One also has, I like their system as well. Until you bump the throttle or a stick to a certain amount, the PID control is inactive when you arm.
Yeah, you can set that up in pretty much every firmware. There are settings, and there's usually, in some firmwares, they have a threshold. So basically your PID controller doesn't arm until 20% or 10% or whatever the hell it is. And air mode as well. You can adjust when air mode kicks in. So you can actually set that up pretty much in every firmware that, so that way you can exactly troubleshoot, pick it up, play with it. And then you can bump your throttle if you want to activate your PID controller, because then if you're getting some weird oscillation, you know there's something going on that you have to continue looking. And I mean, my point here is software, unfortunately, is a little bit more of a multi-headed beast. There's a lot more going on under the hood there, and there's a lot of connections being made that a lot of us don't know or even necessarily want to care about. But it's the same thing, man. You want to try to eliminate things in your troubleshooting process. And if you can eliminate part of the software through the steps, starting just from spinning the ESCs, then spinning with the flight controller with no PID controller, then spinning with the PID controller, and you going down that process, you're slowly ruling out variables. I'm sorry, Red, go.
Well, that, and you know, you can kind of distill everything down into its simplest form. Like, there's only four things that's going to cause a quad to flip the fuck out when you arm it and try to give it some gas. Most of the time, you know, like me, for instance, would be an outlier where the motor configuration was way out of line. But usually you can distill things.
Mixer too.
Yeah. But usually you can distill them to like really basic things, and then you can just kind of go through, well, let's check this, and kind of come up with like a workflow. And actually something else I want to touch on is back to my lesson in just striking out is, no matter how locked down, you think you have shit, you should still always check.
Mm-hmm.
And I deal with this at work because I do support for other IT companies, and I'll identify an issue with like their firewall, and they're like, no, it's not that. You know, there was no possible way it could be the firewall, and then turns out it's the firewall because someone went in there and made a change, but they were pretty sure it wasn't that. And that was a blind spot in their troubleshooting, and they had to call me to figure it out for them.
Right.
That kind of touches on the point where I said, you don't really know it's a problem until it's a problem and you figure out that it's your problem. And you don't even know to look for it until you run into it.
And so it's no matter how good you are, no matter how smart you think you are, no matter how, you know, oh, it can't be, you should probably check. Because you never know. And especially with pre-flight checks. Like, Chad knows what I'm talking about with 10 inches. Like, you have to check it every single time before you fly, because shit will get loose no matter how tight you have it, what kind of Loctite you have. Shit's going to get loose. So you need to check it before every flight.
Oh, yeah, I used to race motocross on quads, man. And I tell you what, man, there's nothing more important. I literally had a fucking A-arm like rattle itself loose mid double.
Oh,
10 foot up in the air. And I mean, I was real lucky because I'm fat as fuck, but yeah, check your shit, man. I've also had that where I was doing something really stupid and didn't check my gear before I went out. I was got my fucking quad stuck on a fucking 20 story building.
Oof.
Never saw that one again.
Oof.
Because literally the motor just came off because the motor mount was loose, like the nuts, the bolts were loose.
Yeah, one of the newbie things that I did when I was starting out in the hobby is I smashed the motor, time to replace it. Okay, it's on the quad, let's get out and fly. And then about 30 seconds in, there goes the motor, there goes the bolts. Then tighten them bitches.
Oh boy. Exactly. I've done that with props where I put all four props on and just like hand tighten the nuts and then go around and tighten them and then just forget one and just pop out, get about, you know, 100, 200 yards, just far enough away to be a pain in the dick to walk to. And the prop just goes, as soon as I throttle up to pop up over something, it's just like, pew!
I had that happen once, but luckily, like, it happened right in front of me. Like, I armed it, kind of sat there for a second. I guess I got the prop a little bit loose, so that when I tried to give it some throttle, it just went whoop.
I mean, just little stuff like that is just super important. Super, super important to double check, triple check, Loctite your shit. Like, especially things that you don't touch again, like bottom screws on standoffs, Loctite them. You never have to take them. I mean, 9 times out of 10, in most crashes or repairs, your average repairs, you're not having to take the bottom plate off.
No.
It's usually just loosing an arm, pulling the arm out, or unless you've got a unibody. And then I just say get individual arms because unibodies are stupid.
I don't like unibodies. Like, damn, did the marmot have, like, great resonance? Because it was just solid. And I actually won the lottery on the space grade carbon that they have. Because some, you know, not all of it was bad. And I won the lottery on the frame that I got. So it didn't break, you know, with a stiff breeze. But boy, when it broke, eventually,
it's just like, it was like a ending situation. That just sucks.
Oh man.
Gotta transfer everything over. That's a bitch.
Then I got the Badger and I'm like, hey, I want some spare arms just in case.
Never need.
Still on the original arms.
Exactly. That's what's nice about that. But let's move to chat and see if anybody has any questions or anything like that. Any of you boys in the chat got any questions you want to run across about some troubleshooting shit that you got or have had or anything?
Stories.
Give it to us, man. Otherwise, we're gonna break into showing
some dumb dumb moments like what I had on Sunday.
All right. Well, cool. I just actually was checking something out. I'm trying to get something going here. So,
You're rubbing one off screen.
Yeah, dude. So I'm actually going to pull my mic way over here. Yeah. Let me do this. Oops. So I got this rig over here, right? I wanted to show you guys a couple quick things. I'm going to move my
toys.
So yeah, I have a scope here and I have a meter. All right. So I would say that every person that builds quads absolutely needs to own a goddamn meter.
Yeah, if you don't own a meter and you mess with electronic anything.
I mean, like a meter is so
you're doing clutch. Yourself a disservice. That's all you're doing.
And I think it's important. Like
one of the first things I bought.
When you buy a meter, that number one, you get some clip leads of some kind. They have alligator clips. These are good for hooking on component legs. Alligator clips can be kind of unwieldy, but are good for big, you know, again, right tool for the job, right? So you you want to have...
What is that, a blue point?
What, the meter?
Yeah.
No, it's something I got. Amp probe? It's a decent meter. It sure ain't no fucking fluke, but
yeah.
Get some fucking probes, okay? Get some probes, get some clips, and probably some alligators. And they have kits that have tons of different shit, but get some different kinds of shit. Because, again, right tool for the job. If you need to get in tight...
Yeah, there's no excuse. Amazon's got them for like...
Yeah, you can get like
$2.99. For like a package of three different kind of connectors.
Yeah, and you know, and you can get. I think this meter is like less than $100. I don't think it's that expensive. Maybe it's a hair.
You don't even need an expensive meter. You can go to Harbor Freight and get a $9 meter.
Yeah,
it will do everything that you need it to tell you, you know, whether it's safe to plug in or not.
This one,
or help you diagnose.
This one will actually use. Bad. I can do since I'm a 3D printer. This one actually, I can hook up thermocouples to it and thermistors and shit. It will read capacitance, and it has a frequency counter in it. So those are all useful things for somebody like me that are doing like 3D printing, and I'm also an audio guy. So in a pinch, I can use it as a frequency counter. So
exactly.
So like that's pretty dope, and it's like I think it was like an $80 meter, and it has really good ratings. So I wanted to show you guys this. This is a cap. Let me bring myself up full screen for a sec. So this is a cap. It's obviously seen some damage, right? Obviously,
oh God.
Obviously seen some pancaked. Damage, right? It is pancaked. But
jeez.
I'm using this cap. It's a known bad cap, right? So I'm using the cap just to kind of demonstrate what a bad cap does. It's got, you know, the fucking, whatchamacallit. Waffle cap on it. Yeah, cap on it. So say you're... One thing I recommend you do before you fucking start using a cap or even building with a cap is at least check the cap actually works, all right? So, like, there's a quick and easy way to... There's a quick and easy way to do that, and that is literally, number one, to just tone it out. So I'm going to come over here and... click on my known bad cap. You can probably
it should just shoot up in voltage and then hit infinity, right?
Well, that's a good cap. So that's we're gonna, cap, well, so yeah. As you can hear, I don't know if you can heard this thing, but I got tone.
Yeah,
okay. Bad. If you have consistent tone across the cap, the cap is shorted. All right, the cap is no is fucking good. That is not a good thing. All right. So that is number one, all right? Just check your cap and see if you get tone, okay? If you got tone, it's a bad cap. And they come bad from the fucking factory. There was actually a big lawsuit because a bunch got shipped to, like, Samsung and shit, and they were bad. All right, so now I have a good cap, known good cap, right? So, again, we're just going to do our little clippy leads.
Do you have a preferred cap that you like to use?
Rubicon, if I really want to get fancy, but at least a good high quality Panasonic
low ESR
FM series is all right. Yeah. There's a couple different variations in that F series that are definitely fine for what we do. But in this case, you know, it's on overload. So what I actually want to do is number one, It's overloaded, which is actually, that's a charged cap. So as a cap charges, it builds up in resistance, okay? Overload, that means this is on the range that I'm in currently. It is It is grown outside of auto ranging. So one thing I want to say is before you start, right, short your cap out. Okay? Short your cap out. Make sure that your cap is shorted out. I don't recommend doing this with big, like, 100-volt caps, yeah, but somehow, like, if you have a bigger cap, put a resistor across it. Make sure that you short both sides of the resistor legs across your leads, and that will drain your cap, okay? So, anyways, what should happen now is that once your cap is discharged, is when you plug it in, this is going to climb up. Okay, and it's auto-ranging, so as you can see, it's climbing up in resistance. So what's happening is my meter is actually charging the cap, and it's auto-ranging up through the various resistance. Now it's in k-ohms, sorry, and it's about to hit meg, and it's just going to keep going, okay? And ultimately, it should climb extremely high and or hit overload completely where it's just... it's just registering. So what OL means is it's open or it's just infinite resistance. And that's what a cap should do. Okay. So that's a super fast way to check your capacitor, right? Boom. Now this meter also, and again, you're going to want to short it out. But this meter in particular, it's an AM 530 and I got it on Amazon. I don't remember what it cost. It wasn't too expensive though. You could put it in cap mode, and what it should do, if it works right, what it should do is it takes a few minutes, and it should ultimately give you a reading. This is 1,000 microfarad cap, and so after it read it, it came up to 976. So that means that whatever the plus or minus 25% tolerance, blah blah blah, that's close enough to 1,000, right? If this was way off, you know that the actual cap isn't performing as well as it could be. So that is another test that you can do if your meter has that as an option, is just quick capacitance checker. All right. A cap, these fucking things will make or break your build in a lot of ways. If it makes sure these things are tight, mounted somewhere tightly, they're not rolling around in any way, shrink wrap them to a standoff, I don't care, use a cap, but ideally get it as close to the source of power as you possibly can within your build. It's not always possible.
That's key.
But that's clutch. Get it as close as you can. It will be more effective. The more wire you add to the cap, the more you reduce its effectiveness. But so short runs, short as possible. In the end of the day, it's still going to work, guys. Don't get me wrong. It will work, but it won't work as well on your LiPo. I do it. I stick them on my XT60s. There's times I can't fit the fucker. It happens, all right? But
yeah, I use the waffle.
It works. But that's pretty clutch to do, because you can put a cap in your build and have all sorts of weird problems, and you're like, what the fuck's going on? And especially a good symptom of that is your VTX browns out or resets on punch out, because what's happening is the cap isn't working, and it's spite your system is backfeeding too much current down to your VTX. And in the case of like Vincent, I think even myself, when you get a situation where your motor stops moving, you can actually basically you're dropping DC back into your flight controller, which is bad. All right. So
no likey.
So another thing that I've been talking about here is this is a TVS diode, and this is rated for 6S. And this is a little square guy. And I just soldered, it's a surface mount device, and I just soldered leads on it, and normally I would shrink wrap it when I'm done, and I would E6000 it to my cap or something. But basically, a diode, and why diodes are cool, is it only lets current go one direction, the direction it's meant to be going, okay? And it basically acts like a one-way water valve. It lets water go one direction, and then when the water tries to go back, it closes and stops the water from going backwards, okay? And with this meter, again, and everybody has a diode checker on their thing, it, right, as you can see, is from black, red, it's letting current go from the anode to the cathode. But if you turn this around and do black and black and red, all right, you don't see any, you don't get a reading, you get a short, because that's the diode doing its job. It is not letting current flow backwards. So you get infinite resistance. So that's a diode check, and there's diodes all over. They use these for almost like popper stoppers, honestly. You can use them for that almost.
Nice.
There's a couple quick little things that I personally have learned that I think are really helpful. I do have the scope here, and I wanted to show you guys some other crazy shit really quick, if I can get it wired up and manageable. But I have my busted ass quad here, okay, flight controller dangling at the moment. But I've ripped I have a motor that's questionable, right? So I'm trying to, I still have to dial this setup in a little bit. But basically, I've got the scope here. And what you want to do, ideally, is have all three traces hooked up at the same time. All right. So you would hook up a lead to each motor, and then you would ground between the actual coils. I'm going to do one at a time really quick.
Yeah, step out for a moment.
You're all good.
So I want to show you, if you look at the scope here, when I spin the drill, I'm now getting a sine wave on my scope on that coil. Okay. So to see what I'm going to show you is what I'm doing, I actually have a DeWalt chucked down on my motor. And when I spin it, I'm getting waveforms. Oh, it probably came loose. There we go. Oh, I'm not spinning it, that's why. So now what you can actually do is, if you hook up all three traces, you should see all three traces form what would look like a three-phase power readout. But this is a good way to check to see if a motor's working, if you have a scope. And you can get a scope, you can get a pocket scope for $100 that will do this. And by adjusting the time and stuff, there we go. That's a better readout, right?
Yeah, it's easier to see. Yeah.
So by adjusting your time, you can get a trace, and you should see a sine wave. So this is what a lot of people don't understand. A motor, when spinning, is a generator, okay? And a generator, what a generator does is generate AC, alternating current. So that one's good. I'm going to do the outside pair now. So I was just doing the first pair of wires, right? So you have three wires on a motor, and I was just doing the first pair, okay? So now I'm going to jump to the outside pair, okay? And I'm going to spin it again. And ideally, like I said, you can hook up all three at the same time. There we go. Right? So that one looks good.
That's cool.
And now I'm going to jump to the last pair. And what you should see is a nice, smooth wave. And that's what a good sine wave looks like. If you've got irregularities or square waves, I mean, obviously you want to check and make sure that your scope is set right for the amount of voltage. But if you've got irregularities or it just doesn't work, you know there's a problem in the actual, in those coils. And that's a good way to diagnose motor if you have the tool around.
Yeah, that's a genius way to do that. Just allows you to see it really plainly.
I'm trying to see if I can get more than one hooked up at the same time.
I found a cityscape level in this new game. I'm fucking loving it.
Is this DCL?
Oops. Yeah, it's the new DCL game. Very very light on the gravity. Like, yeah. This is me just falling to the ground.
Oh, wow.
It's super
light. Wow. So there's a big difference there.
Yeah, it's a monstrous difference.
I'm going to need to check that. Well, that's my setup, actually. So, as with everything, Going the wrong way.
So I didn't know that the DCL game was available.
Just came out. So, oh, there you go. Yeah, so now you're seeing the phase. Okay, there you go. You're starting to see phase relationship. Let me get the last one hooked up. Yeah, the DCL just came out, and Liftoff just had a big release with a new
level. Played it for the first time today, the Digga Dive.
How do you like it?
Yeah, I was going to load that in, but I was like,
it's actually it's a great tree spot outside of the, you know, the obvious kind of obstacle in it being the Digga, but and that's super fun and cool. I mean, you can do just the absolute biggest Maddie flips around it.
If we were
dive like everything.
Oh wait,
looks like you started to get it.
I don't have a. I have a flat line on one. One's not hooked up right. Oh, it probably doesn't have. One was.
I write down.
There we go.
There we go.
So one of them's matching. I need to check out why. It might be the way I have it wired. But the bottom line is what you get them, once you get them all up, you should have equivalency across all three coils. Unfortunately, I'm doing a lousy demo, and I'd have to strip. I need a new motor. I don't know why it is to grab a motor. I have a motor. Duh. I was kind of trying to show them the real quad.
Yeah, yeah.
But they went from there to there.
What'd I miss?
There to there.
Oh, we broke out the oscilloscope and started spinning up those motors.
That's killing it on that level.
Yeah, it is, man.
This level's fucking so cool looking. I just like the aesthetics of it.
Yeah, it looks like an actual city.
Yeah, you get kind of bored with Liftoff playing the custom levels all the time, you know?
Oh, yeah.
I just wish I could make the quad feel heavier.
Can you not? The physics, you can't change the physics?
I don't think so. Maybe. I don't know, maybe.
Is there like an INI file you can fuck with?
In DCL? Or
I literally just loaded it in today.
How much is DCL?
It's like $70.
It's pretty expensive, actually.
It's $70?
No.
Get the fuck out of here.
Not that much. No, it's much cheaper than that. It was like $25 or something.
Really? I could have sworn someone said 70 or posted 70.
The PlayStation version might be 60.
Yeah, I was going to say. But... I think the PlayStation or Xbox version.
Oh, shit. It's $25 on Steam. I'm going to get it.
Yeah, it sounds. You got to do a bunch of the racings to unlock the levels. But I just did like 5 races, got first place, and I unlocked a bunch of levels.
Yeah, that's gonna take me a minute.
There seems to be some customization stuff, but I haven't fucked with
it. It looks video gamey to some degree.
I mean,
yeah, it reminds me of GTA.
It runs really, really well. It runs really, really well. Like whoever, like it's I'm running with 0 frame loss on Liftoff with the same settings. I get, you know, some less frames.
Right.
But this level is incredibly pretty.
That's a good looking environment.
Nashville. Yeah, it's sick.
Yeah.
Are we still, do we have some people in chat? Like,
yeah, we got plenty.
Are you talking to anybody? Is anybody talking to them?
Yeah.
Everybody's talking about the DCL. Yeah.
Yeah, it's $5 off on Steam. So $25.
Hell yeah, I'm going to hit that.
I actually haven't tried the GTA 5 drone mod, I've heard about it. Kind of want to just do that.
My buddy Dan
had it. GTA 5. Yeah.
And it was
cool.
Can
you use... Yeah. I would like it just to dive all those giant buildings.
Yeah, it's pretty fun.
I have to figure out which wire I'm not doing right here. I'm not getting them in phase.
I don't think there's a transmitter support for consoles.
That's a sick spot.
I don't think there's transmitter support for consoles at this moment either, and it's a drag. I'm PlayStation.
There is a way to do it though. There's people that sell boxes so you can do like a keyboard mouse for for games. So you should theoretically be able to
utilize one of those. Yeah.
Kind of don't know why people are tearing up their controllers to put gimbal stick ends on when you could do something like that.
Yeah, I saw that. I was like, wow. Have you seen all those guys modding the Tango 2 to have 2.4?
Yep. That seems pretty cool.
Pretty crazy. Yeah. I think X-Jet or Bruce kind of
did the first. They're not modding the Tango. They're just building a repeater.
Yeah.
Wrong choice of words. I'm sure somebody's going to go out and.
Yeah, there's going to be a product. There's going to be a product coming out for that. I guarantee it. That's all streamlined and whatnot. Instead of having to make it yourself. Because it's kind of. Because I was understanding it has to be a PPM input or PPM out for Crossfire.
The reality is you've lost, like, you lose all the benefits of a Crossfire link. Because, I mean, you can, you know, if you want to burn it, if you want to burn an RX Nano, you can plug it into an old FC and then plug that in via USB and create a HID.
Yeah.
Well, it should be possible for someone to have it do S-Bus. So I'm sure a product will come out where it utilizes S-Bus, and then you just, you know, you get S-Bus latency, but hey, at least you get to fly your whoops with a Tango 2 without having to weigh it down with a Crossfire receiver.
Right.
Exactly.
I mean, hardcore whoopers are like that, though. They love them shits. Like, they'll run an actual Crossfire RX on them. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, but then you're talking like a 10-15% increase in weight, which sounds like a lot, but it's like 1.5-6 grams.
Yeah, but you're talking about, you know, 30 grams to all up, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you're dealing with a very small.
Yeah, imagine putting it. Crossfire on the Mobile. Like, the Mobile would be like twice as heavy. And now, and it's hard to find those mini Crossfire antennas too. You can either do the Nano, you know, the whip antenna. TBS is making them, but it was not designed by TBS. And you can only buy them on Kebab's website. And they're sold out.
So I just wanted to show you something, Marty. This is the suspect motor. And one is potentially a little janky. Because you can see the yellow is lower.
Yeah.
So I need to check that. I need to check that coil out. Yeah, it doesn't seem like it's working quite as well as the other two. So that's how you reference a fucking goddamn motor. It's pretty cool, though. I mean.
Yeah, that's super sick. I love it. It's so sick. I wish I knew how to use it.
Now, what I'll do is I'll just take this exact same wiring setup and take it to a known good motor and double check myself. You know what I mean? Make sure there's not something I'm missing.
You always have to give yourself a reference.
Always, that's a good, that's always a good thing, is give yourself a reference point. Make sure you know what it's supposed to do or how it normally acts, and then make sure that the other things act the same way.
Exactly.
Where I want to basically, I want to generate tones and use the tones to drive a motor, and then I'm going to introduce noise to that, and we'll see if the motor ESC explodes. But then I'm going to use a filter to pull that out, and so we can watch the motor actually smooth back out. And I'm going to put everything on the scope so we can actually see the effect. We'll see the effect of a filter on a noisy waveform. You know what I mean? And how it can. Help.
That would be cool as fuck.
Yeah, stuff like that. It's pretty nerdy up in here tonight, but you know, what are you gonna do?
we are talking about flying robots, bud.
True.
So nerd up.
So what we're getting close to the end of the evening. Yes.
Do we want some of the videos, or
does anybody in chat have any questions about any of the craziness we've begun to talk about tonight. It's a little haphazard troubleshooting conversation tonight.
Yeah,
just a little bit.
A lot of circling back around, you know, important points like double checking your stuff.
Oh shit!
The outside in.
Yeah, what up, Willie? Fucking Cashwell in the chat. What's up, mad love, man?
Hey, Willie, my doppelganger with a longer beard.
Yeah. So we talked a little bit about video. I would add, I've talked about this before, but I would like to add this again just really quickly. Noisy video, lines in your video.
Oh, that's the worst.
It's 100%. It's 100% the way you have shit grounded almost every single time. And I've talked about this in the past, and I want to touch on it really quickly. For me, video starts with a camera and ends at your VTX. Okay. It should be a straight line. Try to avoid multiple paths of shit, especially power. I like to power from my flight controller. I like to power my VTX from my flight controller, preferably via VBAT pads. Use a high volt VTX and power my camera from that. So it's a straight line from my camera to my VTX power wise, VTX to FC power wise, and it's down to the battery through the ESC or PDB in that case. And then video wise, because OSD wants to see video signal is only one conductor. You still need a ground in there. And if you don't have a ground in there, you're going to end up with issues. And since you have to go through the OSD chip on the FC, you want to make sure you're bonded to the FC ultimately, right? But when you start creating multiple paths for ground, or if you have like your VTX grounded to fucking the battery and the camera's getting powered from the FC, now you're creating weird loops. And that's where you're going to start having problems. That's where you're going to start seeing roll and OSD flicker and things of that nature. So I highly recommend if you have to, like, say you're using a 5 volt, you know, VTX, I recommend a Beck unless you're damn sure that your FC can handle it. I understand the micro guys want to shave the weight, but, and then again, try to power your camera from the same place, but always try to bond it to the FC somehow. You know what I mean? From the last one I built, I powered my everything off my FC 5 volt because I had a 2 or 3 amp Beck on the flight controller. So I made sure my grounds for my camera and my VTX were bonded together and then soldered to the same point, and my power, and you know what I mean, and things of that nature.
I mean, I think that's the biggest thing is making sure that your camera and your FC and your VTX are all grounded in the same point.
And I mean, you might think that just because the FC ultimately goes to the ground on through the PDB or whatever, that it's all going to ground. Yes, it is. But what you can create is, like I said, you can create loops. You create circles when you start creating these extra power runs. Now you're creating loops, and the noise can get sent from one loop to another, and it can even feedback. So you can end up with crazy roll in your video streams and stuff like that. I don't know if there's anything else. Again, if your VTX is browning out or something like that, a lot of times it's a cap.
Kyo's asking, how would you apply the diode on your build?
Across your LiPo input to the PDB or the foreign one. In this case, the manual, you won't be able to see this, unfortunately. It's just too small, I think, and I'll never get the focus. On one side of, there's a stripe on one side of this diode, and the manufacturer tells you which way to wire it, right? And in this case, it's the positive. This is, I think, a reverse BIOS scenario where the cathode is going to the positive and the anode is going to the negative. But anyways, I just wire it up to black and red as per direction and straight across my LiPo pad, right onto where my LiPo comes in on the PDB or the ESC.
Mike's Camping in FPV had a kind of interesting idea, putting a diode in line with the VTX on the power side that can handle the load and then make the voltage only go in one direction so you don't get any voltage spikes. which is certainly interesting. I wonder.
You can, as long as your cat, like, think about it, as long as your cat, that's why I'm recommending you powering your camera from your VTX. Because now, yeah. What if you don't power your camera from your VTX? You can throw that over on the VTX. But if your camera is not also protected in that same way, then noise will get into the camera and can get sent down the video signal line and right back into your VTX.
Well, that's also why I recommend twisting both your VTX and your camera cables. I just seem to get better results and cleaner video once I started doing that as well.
Since I've started twisting, I've gotten the same effect since I've started twisting.
Well, that's an interesting point because the reality is I'm going to use two cigarettes as an example. Ha ha ha. Don't smoke, kids. Please. Cigarettes. So what happens is that in a straight line, you have what you have in the middle is, in this case, tobacco, but in the middle of a wire, it's copper, right? And the outside is an insulator, silicon or whatever. It's an insulator, right? Well, how do you make this guy right here?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So what is in this is a hot and a negative with an insulator in between them, okay? And it has a certain threshold that allows power to pass, right? In this situation, you're building capacitance, and capacitance can show up as noise. So if you cross them, it actually cancels it out.
Exactly.
And so it's actually one crazy thing that I do, and I'm not 100% sure because I haven't, honestly, I haven't scoped it. I should scope it. But I've had, if you have a noisy ESC or just ESCs in general, when I use the bundle, I actually tie my ESC. I use a longer ESC bundle wire, and I'll tie a knot in it, and then I connect them because you're actually canceling. You're creating a cancellation of all that signal and motor noise in that knot. Because if you look at any fucking figure or any standard knot, you're creating a cross.
So it's like phase?
Yeah. I mean, dude, high power systems, like when we do gigs, Wombat could speak to this too. When you do when you do feeder, which is like 4-aught cable for, and you're running 3-phase, you have 3 hot legs and a negative and a ground, you don't want to roll it into a coil. Because what are you doing? When you put in a coil, now with inductance, how do you make a transformer? Well, you take a bunch of insulated wire and use that capacitance to make a fucking inductor, a big field. You create a magnetic field, right? And so one way to eliminate that is to coil it as a figure eight, so there's a cross in it and it keeps crossing, because what you're doing is you're taking those waves and you're putting them out of phase, and it cancels out.
Yep.
It's a crazy little thing, right? But
ferrite does the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you find it on the end of like on the end of a wire.
Mouse is like, on your mice. They used to put them on your mice and your USBs, because USB is notoriously noisy. Actually,
really?
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
They're not the most, despite being a standard, they're not the most well thought out thing.
A lot of times, do you ever wonder why the USB has that like big old like tube, like basically fucking? You're like, what is this? A lot of times, there's a fucking ferrite in there. Ferrite ring in there. Because it's audio. Anytime you get like a high end audio USB interface, that shit. There are little tricks. It's unfortunate. Is there a ferrite what?
Or just, it's just tape.
No, it's a ring.
No.
It's an actual ring.
Okay, I've seen that.
It's basically like a magnet.
How would you use that on a quad? Would you just wrap it around the ring?
Well, like I don't recommend you use ferrite rings in a quad.
No, they're too heavy.
It's just too big and heavy. And
I was just asking.
Ferrite rings are not practical for quad use, typically speaking, but there are ways to emulate that, I guess, in wiring, potentially, just the way you lay your wires out. Crossing things at a 90. If you have to cross wires, try to cross it at 90 as best as you can. You know what I mean? Yeah, if you running things,
minimizing
running
parallel to each other is bad. Yeah.
Yeah. Running things parallel to each other can be bad. And in creating a weave, like you're saying, like twist it together, you're creating phase breakup basically. So yep, it helps.
Exactly.
It helps cancel out noise. Extra. I'm not. I'm going 2 inches. I don't bother. I'm not going to lie. If I'm going 2 inches, I don't bother. Some people are, you know.
I'm a stickler for it, man. Because because for the longest time when I was running 4S, there was never a cap on my builds at all.
Right.
And that's what made the difference for me was I started twisting wires and my video just ended up cleaner.
Yeah, because end of the day, any electricity running through something is going to create a magnetic field, and that magnetic field's going to want to mess with other things.
So wreak havoc or whatever it can. Another place this is really important and where I definitely recommend that you twist wire is your ESC signal and ground and telemetry wires. If you're running ESC telemetry on single ESCs, twist that shit. It's because you're running right along a big-ass high amperage hot negative coming from your FC. So you're running parallel to high amp, hot negative, and then you're putting signal and telemetry data, which telemetry data is actually really susceptible to electromagnetic noise. So twist that shit. APD, advanced power drives, they recommend that, and we have noticed on a couple people's builds when they build them and they use like bonded cable. I've seen somebody use bonded cable, right? Three conductor bonded, and their telemetry was going fucking haywire. You know,
well, it's so, like back in the day when they used to ship wire already soldered onto ESCs, you would always get
typically be like twisted.
Akon and SPEDX, yep. the signal and grounds would always be twisted.
Yeah.
Now I don't think that's necessary on things like KISS, as long depending on the distance that you're traveling.
Because I'm
using 12 millimeter wires to go from my PDB to my ESC.
Right.
There's no issue there. I've never had an issue there.
And honestly, you should be having your ESCs as close as possible to a flight controller.
Yes.
Exactly.
Absolutely. And
another good point.
And I mean, and as you go up in power, I mean, you know, again, on 3S or 2S or something, these factors are lessons, you know, but as you get into 6S and 8S and 12S and up, this shit becomes super critical.
Oh, yeah.
You know, honestly, I was considering on my 8S build using a shielded triple pair, where, you know, running my three wires and then shielding that and running my shield to ground.
You could probably get away with some Cat 6.
Yeah. it wasn't so fucking. If it wasn't solid cord, I went stranded. But fucking Cat. I hate Cat to some degree, but yes, you're absolutely right. You probably could. You know, it'd be amazing, actually, Cat-based ESC system. But
yeah. Right.
But that's another one. Like, actually, if you have funky telemetry issues or funky issues with an ESC, and you haven't, woven your wires, try doing that.
Try it.
Especially if it's a long run, and especially if you're running 6S or up, you know, 5S even probably. I would say from 4 up, you might as well just fucking make sure you're doing that.
Can't hurt anything.
Yeah, absolutely. I am. I'm curious how like the guys like doing like 24S. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, I wonder, man. I wonder.
Powertrains on that size, like 6S will blow shit up. But 24S, dude. Holy shit.
It's a nuclear fucking Jesus. Holocaust.
It's a whole nother level of EMF too, man. I mean, it's just so again, you know, good grounding, I think, is paramount. It is a foundation to any build,
any electrical system. Period. Ground is
trying to run as best you can a straight line to ground from your components in the chain of things. You know, like I said, think of your camera, DTX. FC, ESC, battery, you know, motors, ESC, battery, right? You know, like, you don't want to have any weird shit going on. Every time you start doing that, you you just create potentials, you know. And if a ground goes bad, you know, that current's got to go somewhere. So if a ground goes bad and that and for whatever reason your high current line has failed on the ground side, that current's going to go somewhere, and it might go down through your flight controller just because it needs to get back to that battery ground some one way or another. And if it goes to your flight controller at that point, your flight controller's toast. So, word.
So let's show some of these videos that we've got, some guinea vids. As long as nobody else has any questions about this troubleshooting and whatnot.
I got to hop off.
Yeah, it's getting
a little late for me.
Getting that time. Yeah, we're gonna roll some videos and call it. Well, first, so tell. All right, so E-Rod got featured on the Rotor Riot video. Is that correct?
He did.
Yep.
The community spotlight.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Shout out to E-Rod. Yeah, that dude's killing it. Every time I see his new next video, is just leaps and bounds better than the last. It's awesome. Putting in the work out.
Did
there,
you see really his like clip? His clip of the best combo ever or whatever.
Oh yeah, yeah. That
it was
pretty
sick. Ridiculous. It was sick. Literally was the best combo ever. I like hands down.
All right, cool. So this is
I want to know how many times.
Yeah, how many crashes it took?
How many times you crash, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
All right. So this is E-Rod, yo. On the community spotlight.
Progression video. We've got a pilot. Hoping you guys learn. This is a trick tutorial. I love trick tutorials and I love seeing pilots try doing trick tutorials and sharing their knowledge and their own way of approaching tricks and their own style. So Rodo here is doing a sideways
Rodo.
Is that like Frodo?
Cleanest sideways power looping I've seen. This guy, I've actually had my eye on. He has got a lot of really impressive videos. Definitely check out his channel, not just for this really helpful trick tutorial, but all of his flying is really great. This video isn't even his best flying, but I wanted to feature this clip because I think it's so excellent when pilots go out of their way to try and help
say what?
Share their knowledge and their skills and help everybody.
There it is.
I gotta get out and work on this stuff. He's got some tips here. I need to find myself a branch and start doing the loopy things. And that brings us to our final category for this episode of Community Spotlight. And I don't know what to call this category. There's only one video. Just look at this video.
Just look at this video.
This guy only has.
Oh, are we done?
That was pretty much it. Yeah, that was it.
I thought we were watching his video. Do we have an actual video from him?
Oh. Yeah. Yeah, it's in the chat.
Yeah, just go to them.
Which one are they?
Maybe I did.
I just wanted to.
Never mind. No, I didn't. Sorry. I thought you said you had
it. Vice, that's the second fail 2 weeks in a row. Last week,
you
gave me a wing video for fucking hip hop last week. And this week, he's like, I thought you were.
Yeah, because that's all he flies.
They're talking about an echo in the chat.
An echo where?
I don't know.
Oh, let's go see.
An echo. All right. So, anyways, do we have a video?
Yeah, I'm going to get you one here in a second.
Is there an echo
There's
now?
Other ones. Here, I'm dropping it in the Zoom chat.
It was the video that had an echo, supposedly.
Interesting.
I don't think so.
I got to bounce, guys. I'm tired.
All right, cool, bro.
It's been fun.
Hi, man. Have a good night, dude.
All right, let's see.
Take care, everyone.
Let's see if this has an echo. All right.
Just GoPro and stuff. Got ourselves a police escort with Bando.
Is this where we pay for parking?
This is where epic music starts right now.
Machines and wires.
I always love those TikToks where you come out backwards and flatten out and then come back forward.
Yeah, I've been working on adding that to my repertoire.
You know what I've been working on lately is kind of the Rubik's out of a inverted yaw. Just doing the double roll and then front flip out.
That'd be nice.
Yes, dope. Vic FBB always does that shit. Drives me crazy, but I'm not any good at it. So I'd start practicing. Because I love it. I'm like addicted to the Rubik's. I can't help but do it.
My Rubik.
Every few tricks, I'm fucking locked on it. I can do it in any direction. Pretty much through any gap.
I've been trying to work on those. I don't know what they're really called, but I call them like momentum tricks, where you're kind of like tossing the quad in a certain direction, like sideways, backwards. Like, that's kind of literally all I've been focusing on.
Well, you know what I really like about that kind of stuff is when you're doing that, all those zero throttle kind of moves, where you're, you know, throwing yourself up and then kind of tick-tocking back and forth, or sort of like Blackbird does. Those French guys.
Such a 6 foot. Oh man, what? I'm like, okay, there's this. They come back to the bottom.
How do I get out of here? Oh, yeah. That bando juice.
Oh.
Yuck. Oh, always hate having to fucking fish into that shit.
Oh, that face you make when.
Yeah.
Time to go.
But the problem with me, man, time to go. In Atlanta, man, it's always some like fucking homeless dung on the floor somewhere you just don't want to hit.
Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, I got this.
So I gotta troubleshoot something. Not now, but I gotta do it later.
What happened?
Oh, I just realized, well, when I made a change to so I don't blow you guys up with audio, and when I did that, I'm feeding back the videos. I'm recapping the videos twice, and I saw it. So as soon as he said echo, I'm like, wait a minute. After the last echo escapade, I'm just like, yo, we are not doing this again. But I know how to fix it at least for night.
We got a quick question from 608 who wants to know what kind of mics we're using. I'm using just a CAD USB mic, but I think they got some fancier ones.
Mine is just the Audio Technica AT2020,
which is a fucking solid podcast mic. I might add, that's a solid choice.
It's a great under $100.
Audio Technica's legit
mic. It's an XLR. I definitely recommend an XLR over a USB.
Yeah, but then you need to buy. Do you need to buy a mixer? Yeah,
then
as
you,
well,
you. But then you need an interface of some way.
So you guys, I want to.
Mine's a USB.
I'll show you guys why audio is complicated. This is why audio is complicated. This right here is why audio is complicated in the stream. It's a little bit.
It's kind of nice having a sound engineer taking care of all the stuff.
I need to actually, though. Yeah. So what I need to do is make a return of my voice here that's clean. So I need to create a send of my voice, and I need to send it to the motherfucker over here.
Nice.
So let's see. We're going to go.
Oh, you're not kidding about these trees.
Yeah, it's dope, man. They're nice trees, good spacing.
Yeah. Fuck the Duga. I want to do some tree style.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I ended up doing when I first got there. I was like, I dove the Duga. I maddied it. I did a couple more dives. And I was like, okay, the trees are so much more
fun. All right. So. We're troubleshooting. So what I've done is I've created a clean mix of my mic. All right. And I'm going to go to. Let's see if this works. Well, that didn't work. It didn't work. Shit. I'll have to do it later. All right. Anyways, I gotta fix that. Oh. I bet you I know why it didn't work.
No, I just realized I'm not sharing the screen. Stupid.
Oh.
Yeah, you are.
This is why it didn't work, because I didn't turn up the actual send. Let me try it again. You got it. What's the next link while I'm screwing around?
There's a couple at the top or right under.
Did it work now? Oh my God, I'm probably too loud. Holy shit. 2-2. Vince, can you hear me talking right now?
Yeah.
Yep, I can hear you. You're a little loud, but not particularly.
Sweet. So that's live troubleshooting right there. I just troubleshot my audio program. So now if I play a video, let's see if it works. Okay. Will it work?
There's another link I dropped.
608 says it's good.
608 says it's good. All right, we're going to go to the next video Artie's got here. Hold on.
Did I just give you the same link?
Did you? You did. You did. You gave me the exact same link. Whoops. Good thing I didn't take it yet. Our show's falling apart. We're troubleshooting our own shit.
Here we go. Try that one.
Oh, almost got it.
Oh.
He has red beard.
Red beard. All right, let's go. Let's see if there's any echo on the video. Don't worry, I'll fix it if it does. Is audio clean? Second,
don't you tell me what you think. No echo. I'm the one at the sail. I'm the master of my sea. Oh, ooh, Big ups to 608 for giving us a heads up.
I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, shook of me, feeling me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the... Hey, you back me up, believer.
So jealous of all their Florida spots and their Florida weather. Oh, this is that spot that E-Rod yo hit. I think it's what he used as his final battle video.
Yeah, I think I remember this spot.
It was like a nighttime flight though.
Here's one video where he's like in a train station. I'm like, that is sick.
I think that's what this is, dude.
Yeah, I think it's the same spot. That's such a crazy spot. You got a big-ass parking lot, and then the train station. Yep, this is it. This is such a sick spot. Look at that. Look how low he gets into the tracks.
Oh, that was close.
Yeah. Redbeard's killing it.
Dude, he's gotten so much better over the last several months. Nuts.
He sent a couple of stickers to KO Pride, and he hooked me up with a few.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I got one right next to my Mad Chiller sticker right here. You're the flames, you're the face of the future, the blood in my veins, oh, ooh, the blood in my veins, oh,
ooh. But they never did ever lived, ebbing and flowing in here. Oh!
Nice.
Oh, that was it.
Ah!
Leave you one
cut short.
Put up that mic, bro.
Oh,
now we're echoing.
No worries. That was just
that's a normal. That's a situation normal.
Yeah, we're cool. We use two
all
mics.
Fucked up.
Yeah, because we use two mics.
That's a snafu.
All right, let's play one more.
What the fuck? Hold on a second.
I still have work to do.
I want to play.
I have like 2 hours of work, 3 hours.
What the fuck? Nice. Hold on a second. This thing is all fucked up.
I can dive the easy part of the Duga, but I haven't been able to dive the hard part.
I'm glad this is not live because I'm finger fucking the shit out of my keyboard right now. I wanted to play. No, I mean the.
No, I know.
All right, you know what? Actually, this is a cool spot. I want to play. A buddy of mine comes out to the streams all the time, and I hope this is a good one because I haven't actually had a chance to watch it yet. Buddy of mine comes out to the stream every time, and I want to play one of his videos because I was going to play it the week before last. And yo, so this is Dragon Ears here in NYC, y'all.
Oh yeah. Dragon Ears, man.
And this, my friend,
taught me practically everything I know.
For you.
Love that track.
Yeah, Dragon always picks himself. Oh, there's our bando. I can't wait to go back. I don't think there's not a week where I don't dream of going back to that spot.
This is like the song that I want in the background of my life.
It's like this spot is so, it's like very small, but it's the structure is just so sick.
So is there no like entry into it?
It's kind of just this big.
This is a lonely field, like, man. Look at it. It's just a lonely.
Yeah. There's literally nothing around except for this.
It's a lonely tower in the middle of a field.
Hey, we got one. There's one tree behind it. It's an old cotton mill.
Yeah, there used to be stairs in that tower, but they took them out because the gangs used to throw people off and kill them.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
It's gnarly.
No evidence, you know what I mean? Why use a gun or a knife? Just push them off. Oh shit, we got E-Rod Yo in chat. You just missed playing your video.
Shit, you just missed it, bro.
Rewind that shit.
See, that's a proper rewind right there.
how did I know that was going to come up?
We were having a conversation about rewinds and how some DJs make it cheesy, but rewind has a history.
Special place.
It's all about respect. Hell yeah.
So hopefully I'm going to try.
Yeah, you can drive us.
Spring, man. But y'all going to be
think
driving.
About being a New Yorker.
Yo.
None of us have cars.
I have to rent a car.
Dragon Ears killing it.
Killing it, dude.
Good shit, dude. I was, like I said, I was meaning to play one of his last week. Did we have a Baldwin video too?
Yeah. I dropped it in the, it's the last link in the chat.
Good man.
That was Dragon Ears, E-Rod Yo.
Is it timestamps already or
no?
Okay, it started a couple seconds in. But... Hey, here we go.
E-Rod Yo's coming to New York soon.
Huh? What?
E-Rod just said he's coming to New York.
Fuck yeah, we'll go out to the bando, bro.
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
Fuck all y'all.
That's funny.
I got a bando out here I want to hit, but nobody to fucking come with me. I'm too worried about getting stabbed by a fucking homeless person.
Dude, I'm gonna come by. I'm gonna come. I got a friend in Tennessee. I'm gonna come visit you, and then I guess I'll go see her.
Come on, bro. I got a guest room for you. You got a bed.
He's got his stick cam and his DVR.
Oh yeah, he's killing. I like this spot too. Their fucking trees are so dope.
They're just like, they're so tall and there's just no leaves in the middle.
Yeah, and it's just wide, so you can just get that nice float over. I thought this had music.
Yeah,
oh,
where's
nice.
It? I was gonna say, doesn't. Oh, it's his. I was trying to figure out what was the ambient noise. It's his mic next to him. Okay. See, it's the sound guy in me. I can hear shit.
Yeah.
He likes that raw footage. Listen to motor noises.
I don't mind motor noise, but...
I don't mind motor noise, but I want a beat with it.
Yeah, give me...
All right, Baldwin, whatever you're using for your other mic is noisy as heck. It sounds like a white noise generator. Yeah, it sounds crazy. Why
not? It's that chesty cam, like. Dope fly, man.
Yeah, sick footy. You need an audio engineer.
Excited.
Oh, shit.
E-Radio is asking if we know Spark.
Spark? Yeah.
Spark with an X.
Sparks? We talk with... If it's Sparks, we talk to him every day in Discord. Oh, nice backwards. Get it, boy. Oh!
Yeah, it's such big open spaces, these Florida spots.
Like, yeah, I'm very nice jelly of those spots. It's
lots of big trees, which is so sick.
A little Jacob's Ladder.
If we go to Florida, yeah.
I went to Orlando, man, and it was like, I couldn't find any spot.
All right. It is 12:30.
Yeah, let's call this wrap.
Oh, wow, we went late.
We did go late. So, I'm sorry. I didn't answer. I'm using an MXL 770 mic, but I'm going through a damn I'm going through this thing, the Midas or the Behringer X32 compact mixing desk. So, I have an actual desk. That's on my network.
Chad just whipped his dick out.
I did.
Everybody to see.
He said, dropped it on the table.
Dropped it on a keyboard.
The motherfucking like, mic.
My mic's a USB mic. He's like, yeah, my mixer's worth more than your whole computer.
Exactly.
But this is, MXL's.
With my USB.
So if you're looking for a good podcast mic, the MXL's actually really good. I do recommend with an XLR mic, ideally, if you can afford it, to get a mixer in line of some kind, or at least a mic preamp that gives you some tone control. So
a good interface.
Because like on mine, here I'll whip it. I'll whip out the dick again. On mine,
you know that's what I'll call it from now on. The
dick. On mine, I have an EQ, right? So I can actually shape my voice. Part of the reason why my voice sounds decent on all these videos is this fucking my curve right here, and then I also run a compressor limiter that gives me a little bit of reduction here and keeps my levels better. And I have a gate, so when I shut up, you don't hear the rest of my room. Yeah. So this means it's closed. So that's nice. That. So we've been working on I'm constantly working on the audio system for our show. And my guests were getting blown out. We were getting blown out from the videos. So I just fixed that. But when I did that, I created a loop, talking about loops, and that's why we had an echo. So I fixed that by creating another mix.
Troubleshoot.
And I now have three mix minuses. Three mix minuses running this show. So I have a mix minus that goes to me, so I don't hear my voice, but I hear everything else. A mix minus that goes to them. And a third one. It's ridiculous. I need to fix it.
Well, something that I do want to say before we get out of here is if you guys have any feedback on the show, hey, leave it down in the comments.
Keep
man.
It to yourself.
We know Vice is gay and everybody thinks he's gay. He's not gay.
If you have
any opinions on that, keep them to yourself. But if you got some feedback on the show, let us know. If you want to hear about something or you want us to do a show on something, hey, give us some ideas. We always can always use a little help for those. Try to get some contact that you guys want to listen to, and maybe even some guests that you want to see. Leave that in there too, man. Just
we started about 15 minutes late, so this is about 2 hours and 15 minutes, and we're trying to actually keep it at 2 hours cap. I did get a comment from my one good friend, like, don't make it 3 hours. I'm like, I'm trying not to, dude, but it's easy to do.
Yeah, it's hard to do when you're just hanging out, having a good time, talking shit with the homies.
Hell yes. Yeah. So we get rolling in conversation and we sometimes get sidetracked, and we have to try to keep ourselves in check. And, what the hell? Ow. Yeah.
Stay on target. Bird.
Stay on target.
All right, so you guys got anything else? Vice is now in Simland, so we've lost him.
Yeah, he's gone.
I think, like half the show.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just hey, if you got any questions, always feel free to hit us up on Facebook or in the Discord. That's the best place to hit us up.
Good night, E-Rod. But yeah, I would say if you guys have ideas or things you want to hear from us, we would definitely love to have a conversation regarding those topics, and we are always looking for extra ideas and stuff. Coming up, though, we do have some cool stuff happening. We definitely want to do a maker-centric show regarding 3D printing and some things there and design stuff. That's on my roster as well, and I want to get a couple, notorious 3D printers to come in and share their experiences with us.
Maybe we can get Bill back on.
So we don't have to listen to me just talk about my 3D printing.
Bill did stop by the stream.
Oh, did he?
He did stop by.
I didn't even see him.
Yeah.
We love you, Bill.
I didn't want to blow up his spot.
Come back, Bill.
Love you, Bill. But otherwise, yeah, guys, we'll keep on keeping on. I will show you something cool, although my desk is a mess.
We've already seen your dick.
Hey. So one little addition to our stream. Let me just fix it. Let me fix that. I got to go back to this. I'm going to go to this, and then I'm going to go. All right, so this is the mobile cam, but I do want to show you I have a print. This is Vice's print going on right here.
Oh, yeah.
It's almost done. Oh, look at that. Almost done. Mobile cam is the jam. This is actually my cell phone. So I thought that was pretty fun.
That's super cool. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty responsive. It is actually a decent frame rate. Mobile cam in the future, coming to a show near you.
Yeah,
it'd be sick to be able to do it over cell and like just take off down the street somewhere, go rip on the corner.
Exactly.
That's what awesome. I'm talking about.
I'm just waiting for that FPV Connect. Orca, please send mine anytime you want. As soon as it's done.
Wait, what? What do you want? Which one do we have?
That FPV Connect. Orca. So you can just run your DVR. Oh, yeah. Your feed straight to your phone.
Yeah, that's cool.
Don't need a external screen.
Now, what I challenge you to do is mount a camera to your orcas so you can flip and have a fucking like look around and be able to see what you're seeing around you. Now that would be hot.
Yeah. Didn't Sky Zones have that? The front facing cam?
I don't know. I mean, VR headsets have them. Like most virtual reality headsets have them. So that way, when you're in VR, you can actually flip to the real world real quick. Or you can, like HTC had a thing where if somebody walks into your VR system area, it will automatically go to that camera so you can talk to them or whatever.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's close this piece, bud.
All right.
My ass is getting
We antsy. Love you guys. We're rambling.
Thanks for fucking coming on and hanging out with us all night. I know it's been a long one, but, man, thanks for sticking in there. We really appreciate you guys. We wouldn't do this. And couldn't do this without you, so
hope you learned something. Yeah.
Maybe you learned something. Maybe you just hung out and shot the shit.
Fuck
and
yeah.
Laughed at us.
Well,
and talked about how gay Vince is.
Vince couldn't join earlier. So Artie's we automatically assumed it had to do with his sexuality.
I'm only playing.
When it actually was me working, making that paper, fucking buy BQE hats and t-shirts.
Oh yeah, support Bill.
Indeed.
BQE.io. Have you heard?
By the way, have you guys heard about BQE? BQI? PQE. I can't talk anymore, dude. It's a wrap. We love you guys. We're out of here.
Peace.
Peace out.
Sword of Omens, give me sight beyond sight.